In this video, we will explain the so-called OZI rule and why certain particle decays are suppressed because of it. The reason we know about the OZI rule is a small particle called phi meson. In the quark model, it is composed of a strange antiquark and a strange quark. It is electrically neutral and has spin 1. Therefore, it is called a vector meson. It has a mean lifetime of about 1.5 times 10 to the minus 22 seconds, which is incredibly short. After this time, the phi meson decays into some other particles. Let us consider two of such possible decay products. First, one possibility is that the phi meson decays into two kaons, 1k plus and 1k minus. From the quark content, we see that we are creating an up-anti-up pair in this reaction. The corresponding Feynman diagram would look like this, where the strange quark interacts with the gluon, which in turn creates an up-anti-up pair. The strange antiquark also interacts with the gluon, which gets absorbed by the newly created up quark, and the up quark travels on. Due to the quark content, we see that this yields a k minus and a k plus. Another possibility is the decay into three pions, a pi plus, a pi minus, and a pi zero. If we look at the quark content, we see that the strange quarks are annihilated somehow and we create some up-anti-up and down-anti-down pairs. The Feynman diagram might look something like this. Since we don't have strange quarks in the final states, the strange and the anti-strange must annihilate together. This means the strange quark travels in a curve and on the way it interacts with three gluons. These three gluons create quark-antiquark pairs, the first one a down-anti-down, the next one an up-anti-up, and the last one a down-anti-down again. If we compare this with our quark content above, we can identify the three pions. Now, do both processes happen with equal probability, or is one more likely to happen than the other? Let's first do some theoretical considerations before we look at the experiment. Theoretically, in order to say how likely a decay process is going to happen, we look at the so-called Q value. In short, this is the amount of energy absorbed or released during a reaction. We can calculate it as the difference of the rest mass between the initial state and the final state. The phi meson has a mass of about 1020 MeV. The charged kaons are at around 494 MeV, and the pions have a mass of approximately 140 MeV. Therefore, the Q value of the first decay process is around 32 MeV, whereas the Q value of the second process is around 600 MeV. Usually, the process with the higher Q value is more likely to happen. That is because the Q value is basically a measure for how much phase space the final state particles have. In the case of the kaons, the phase space is rather small. Their kinetic energies do not have a lot of room to move. On the other side, the phase space for the pions is 20 times larger. Their kinetic energies have a much larger range. Therefore, the pionic decay should be more likely to happen by a factor of 20. But here comes the experiment. If we measure the decays of many phi mesons, we see that around 84% of them decay into kaons. How can that be? This question occupied the minds of many physicists in the 1960s. Between 1963 and 1966, three physicists independently came up with an explanation. Their names are Susumu Okubo, George Zweig, and Yuguro Iizuka, hence the name OZI. They proposed the idea that if we can separate the Feynman diagram of a certain decay into initial and final states, just by cutting gluon lines, this decay will be suppressed. As you can see, if we cut the pion diagram here, we only cut gluon lines. But then the initial and final states are completely separated. For the left diagram, we would also have to cut quark lines. The explanation of the OZI rule lies in the asymptotic freedom of QCD's coupling parameter. In the case of the pions, the gluons must have a very large energy, since they alone are responsible for the hadrons in the final state. In the left diagram, you can see that the strange contributions to the kaons travel all the way from the initial state. Therefore, the gluons do not have to bring such a high energy with them. Now, asymptotic freedom states that the higher the energy, the weaker the coupling between quarks and gluons. This means that in the right diagram, where the gluons have a really high energy, their coupling strength to the quarks is really small. Therefore, this diagram does not contribute as much as the left one does. And therefore, the left process is much more likely to occur. The suppressing character of the OZI rule is also the reason why the lifetimes of the J psi and Upsilon mesons are unusually long. But that's pretty much it for this video. Thanks for watching.